I now call upon Mr. Rashmi Bhai Jhaveri to present his response to Dr. Zakir Naik. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Rashmi Bhai Jhaveri.
First of all, I really thank Dr. Zakir Naik for giving me the choice whether I would like to still remain a vegetarian or non-vegetarian. Thank you very much. I would request Mr. Coordinator that would you like to have the rebuttal or my comments now, or shall we have?
No.
Because after all, you know, this is...
No. Now is better, you know, we'll...
Let's have some question answer, if you think.
Question answer we have in the third session. We have three-part session. Yes, Mr. Zaveri, you can continue.
Now, we are totally at the command of the coordinator, so I will...
No, as decided, you know, the same format we keep.
I will obey.
I will not allow Dr. Zakir also to change the format.
Now,
I'll object.
First thing that I will say, it's not a question of whether one is logical or illogical, and it's not a question of the choice that one makes. As I said in my talk earlier, everything is relative, and you have to understand this topic from that perspective. Now, one thing that I will really strongly object with respect to Dr. Zakir's, that not a single religion prohibits non-veg. I am expert, I can say, because I am a student, I have done MA in genealogy, I can say from my religious point of view that Lord Mahavir and our all 24 Tirthankaras very vehemently prohibited non-veg food. I have already given you some quotations. You see, mainly arguments of Dr. Dean Ornish is based on the fact that non-veg food contains excessive protein, cholesterol, and saturated fat. So that is why he said that for healthy and peaceful living, you must have non-veg veg diet. Now, he said that plant has also got life. No, it is not only proved by Dr. Jagdish Chandra Bose, but even our Lord Mahavir, he stated 2,500 years ago that not only plant, air, water, fire, minerals of the earth, they all have life. He has not said that you are allowed to kill this life and maintain yourself. But he was a practical Tirthankara, so he said that those who cannot renounce this world and become Jain Muni. You know, Jain Munis, they don't even kill plant vegetation or even other living beings for their food. They bake the food which is cooked in our house. We'll not go into that controversy that even you kill it and then give them. That's a separate story. But the teachings of Mahavir are very clear that you shall not harm any living being, whether animate or inanimate. Now, because of certain constraint for those people who cannot renounce the world, he has said that at least you can avoid essential killing. He has said that even if you, when you have food made out of plant, it is violence, it is hinsa, but it is necessary. So what I prohibit is unnecessary killing. Friends, this is a very sharp distinction, but very important distinction we should make, that if the alternative is available, we should not go for that alternative which compels us to kill and eat our own fellow creatures. Another thing, sir. He said, plants, in my talk I stated about plant food, and he said that even a lizard can grow tail. That's the only exception. The plants, you pluck fruits, they will give you more fruits. You cut their branches, more branches will grow. See, there is no end to such argument. So let us restrict our argument to this. About medical science, and he rightly stated that medically also he has given certain things. I have also stated. Now it is for the enlightened audience to decide whether the scientific facts that I have given are correct or he has given. It's okay. It's a question of argument. Now he has conveniently forgotten. Please excuse me, I am telling because I am trying to rebut your things. The psychological aspect. When we consume animal food, we also inherit certain animal instincts. What have you to say? Please, in your rebuttal, you can say that. Now, doctors also, most of the doctors prescribe raw vegetable. Now, coming to cooking, most of the doctors prescribe raw vegetables for healthy diet. Only that food or cereals which will not be proper for a human being to consume raw, that only can be cooked. But as far as possible, and in our Indian Vegetarian Congress, we always, whenever we have a meeting, we have most of the food raw, uncooked, and that is more healthy, according to us. About the books, these books were not given by me to Dr. Nayak, and it was given by my friend, Mr. Salecha, who approached me. That's okay, it's nothing very important. Now, I will tell you one thing, that you cannot alter the truth by just loud applause. Okay. If you are impressed by my argument, you may applaud me. Or if you are impressed by the other argument, you can applaud that. But I firmly believe that just because some arguments are appealing to you and you applaud them loudly, will not alter the truth. And I have referred to about one book, Dr. Deepak Chopra. He has also written many books. He is also a physician, practicing physician, like Dr. Dean Ornish. He has also conducted researches. And he has come out with a theory that your food will have a terrific effect on your impulses and urges, your physical development, psychological development, and emotional development. You know, most of the psychological and emotional distortions are because of the flesh food that one eats, and that is why it is prohibited. It is totally illogical to say that by eating animals you are helping vegetarians. We should not worry about the animal population because nature is quite capable of taking care. Why? Because we are rearing more animals for killing. That is why if we are not doing it, look at the jungle. Everywhere the natural cycle is there. Balancing will take care of itself. Nobody has to worry about it. Now, as per the history that Mr. Trivedi also referred and also Dr. Jakir, now I will tell from Jain historical point of view that in our Jain scriptures it is mentioned very clearly that those persons who were living in prehistoric stage, they lived under a tree and they were sufficiently provided by trees. They did not have to go for any killing. Friends, I am of course given more time, but I really personally feel that let's not have a sort of dialogue or arguments between. I would like very much the audience to participate and have more time for question and answer. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Zaveri. We have 5 minutes more. It's taking 5 minutes left. Now I call upon Dr. Zakir Naik to present a response to Mr. Rashmi Bhai Zaveri for 15 minutes only.
Alhamdulillah. Wa salatu wa salam. Ala Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Wa qul ja'al haqq wa zaqal batil. Inna la batila kana zahuka. Munazzil min al-Quran ma huwa shifaa'un wa rahmatul mu'minin wa la yazidu adh-dhalimin illa khasara. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. The respected people on the dais and my respected elders and my brothers and sisters, I welcome once again all of you with Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. I have not conveniently forgotten anything. If you realize, I spoke maybe half minute more than the time allotted. So how can he say I conveniently forgot? If you give me even 5 hours more, if you are willing to stay. Because you are the person who kept time restrictions. You know, less time 30. I had to bargain for 50 minutes. I would love to speak for 2 hours. Even full day, I can do it. Because I'm a marathon speaker. Alhamdulillah. I'm a non-vegetarian. Mr. Zaveri said that I said that no religion prohibits non-veg. I never said no religion. I said no major religion. It is being recorded. No major religion. And Jainism is not a major religion. According to the books you gave me, you gave certain books, Jain is only 0.4% of India, 0.4. Less than 1%. Can you call it a major religion? In India, leave aside world. World out of the question. Negligible. I am very clear cut in my statement. Regarding the argument on Jainism, I can reply, but the coordinator won't give me permission. I am restricted to Islam. You know, I can reply even on Jainism. I am a student of comparative.
Excuse me, sir, you can't interfere when the speaker is speaking.
Brother is saying, I did not say, you can very well see the video cassette. There is not a single major religion which bans or prohibits all non-veg food in general. You can see the video cassette.
Ask your question in question time, please.
Don't get irritated. The diet will help you. Don't get irritated. Brother Rashmi Bhai Zaveri said, I did not answer whether you get animal instinct. I said in my lecture, I think you didn't hear, I said we eat peaceful animals like goat, sheep, because we want to be peaceful. And therefore when I came starting, I always said, peace be on all of you. Further, he said, I didn't state Dr. Dean Ornish. I yet challenge him, if his book is referred by any authentic medical college, authentic book, not just dietary books, that answer already gave by Dr. William T. Jarvis, even scientists and medical professionals are not immune to the ideological thinking of the vegetarians. They aren't immune. It's not a medical book. He may have written a diet book. I am very clear in my words. I don't mix words. And Dean Ornish, whatever his name is, may be very famous. I don't know him. I'm hearing him for the first time. I don't know. I yet ask him to prove and check whether that book is referred as a textbook. Not as a medical book, a text medical book in a college. That shows authenticity. He said, we should not worry about the cattle. Nature will take care. It is you all who are so much worrying. We aren't worrying. Nature made them in such a way that the moment you kill them, they will again come. God is the creator. Allah made them. If we kill lion, tiger, they will become extinct. Therefore, we cannot have their food. The cattle, we can have. God has made them that way. If we don't follow the instruction of God, there will be overpopulation. And regarding cutting of plants, what he said, you know, people say that if you have plants, the mother is yet alive. So in that way, the offspring of the cow, of the goat, the calves, that means can we cut them? Yes. The mother is yet alive. The cow is yet alive. And when the offspring becomes the mother, you can also kill the mother. So even if I agree with this logic, the plant survives. In the animals, more lives are surviving than the plants, if I agree with this logic. Furthermore, I said that best is prevention is better than cure. I agree with Dr. Ornish when he says that, you know, vegetarian diet is helpful for certain diseases. Even I advise that. Well, I said no. But the topic is not which food is healthier, but making a statement, it is banned for human beings. I challenge any authentic medical book. I'm a doctor, not books, whether given by Russia Foundation or Indian Vegetarian Congress, whatever it is. These books are stating things which are unfound, ill-tested, unproved. There's the Islamic method of prevention better than cure, which will answer most of your questions. The Islamic method is there of prevention better than cure. When we slaughter the animal, we do the zabiha. We cut the throat and the windpipe and the vessels of the neck without damaging the spinal cord. Otherwise, the nerve going to the heart may get severed, there may be cardiac arrest. When the spinal cord is not damaged and the vessels of the neck are slit open along with the throat and the windpipe, the heart is pumping, most of the blood flows out of the body. Blood is a very good media of germ and bacteria. If you slaughter the animal in this way, most of the disease transmitted by blood, many which you named, can be eliminated, can be prevented. The meat remains fresh for a longer time if it's slaughtered with the Islamic method. And people say, oh, it's a merciless. No, you all are so mercilessly killing, it dies of pain. When we slaughter in the Islamic method, when we cut the blood vessels of the neck, the blood supply going to the nerve, which is responsible for pain, is severed. So the animal does not feel pain. The animal kicks and reserves. You know why? Due to the gush of flow. The animal doesn't feel pain. It is contracting and relaxing because there's lack of blood in that part of the body. The animal does not die of pain. It dies a painless death. Painless. Painless. We eliminate most of the disease transmitted by blood. Secondly, there are many countries in the world and many people who raise animals. They give them hormones. And one was mentioned by Mr. Zaveri, the name. It's called as VES, diacetylbisterol. It's a hormone injected to cattle so that they become fat and you get more money for flesh. This is haram in Islam. Carcinogenic hormones, if ingested in animal, even if you slaughter by the zabiya method, it is yet haram. It is zabiya but not halal. It is zabiya and haram. If the cattle are injected with hormones, you are not allowed to have those hormones. Neither are we allowed to have cows which are fed with non-veg. Because the Prophet said, any animal that is fed with non-veg, it is prohibited for you. After that, if you take care of hygienic conditions and cook the meat very well, most of the diseases which Mr. Zaveri spoke of, not all, most of them will be eliminated. And in the non-veg flesh food, the most dangerous, which is commonly eaten, is pork. It has more than 70 different diseases which you can get if you ingest pork. More than 70 different diseases. And one of them is ischemic heart disease, which he spoke about. Because pork has more of fat building material than muscle building material, it gets deposited on the walls of the vessels, causing atherosclerosis, hypertension, etc. That's the reason in the Quran, no less than 4 different places, in Surah Baqarah chapter number 2 verse number 173, in Surah Maidah chapter number 5 verse number 3, in Surah Anam chapter number 6 verse number 145, and Surah Nail chapter number 16 verse number 115, it says, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتُتُ وَالْدَّمُ وَلَحْمُ الْخِنْزِيرِ وَمَا أُهِلَّ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ. Forbidden for you for food are dead meat, blood, the flesh of swine, and any food on which any name besides God's name has been invoked. It's haram. So we abstain from it and we prevent several diseases of non-veg. Quran says in Surah Taha, chapter number 20, verse number 81, eat of the food we have provided for you in sustenance, but commit no excesses therein. Most of the diseases, what Mr. Rashmi Bhai Zaveri spoke about, is due to excessive eating. Even if you eat excessive veg food, you will have many diseases. I will not say, don't have veg food. I'm a doctor. I'm not an ideological, neither a fanatic non-vegetarian. So if you prevent eating in excess, most of the disease will be prevented. If you follow the Islamic guidelines, slaughter in the Islamic method, remove the blood, don't give hormones, cook the food very well, hygienic conditions, avoid pork, don't eat in excess, most of the disease can be prevented. It answers most of his arguments. Few are yet remaining. If time permits or in question answer time, if you ask, I will reply. Do you know that talking about healthy food, talking about all research and experiments, I'll talk something which is a fact. According to Dr. William, again very famous person, Dr. William, he says that vegetarian food extends the life of a human being for more than 6 years. If you have veg food, as compared to non-veg food, you will live 6 years longer. Again, hypothesis. Hypothesis. If you analyze, a data was collected about all the people who lived above 100 years from 1932 to 1952. And on this data, a person by the name of O. Cigares, he wrote a book, Living to be 100, 1,200 people who did and why they did it. Everything is mentioned. In it, even diet is mentioned. Do you know out of 1,200 people, how many were vegetarian? How many? Guess. 1,000. Four. Four. This survey wasn't done to prove veg food or non-veg food. It was done for other reasons. But even the diet was mentioned. It's a fact. It's not a research. It's a fact. Out of 1,200 people who lived in the span of 20 years, over 100 years, only 4 were vegetarian. You know alcohol? Alcohol alone. It is a veg diet or not? Alcohol is veg or non-veg? Veg. From juices or fruits. And the disease that are caused by alcohol alone is more than all the non-veg disease put together. one vegetable that. So just for alcohol, I cannot say that all vegetable foods should be banned. Today, scientists, and he'll agree, it's mentioned in these books also, the cause of maximum death in the world today is alcohol, number one. So I don't ban all veg food. What do I say? As Quran says, Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 90. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, innamal khamru wal maisuru, wal anzabu wal aslamu, rijsum min amali shaitan, fastanibul lakum tuflihun. That, oh, you believe? Verily, intoxicants and gambling and idol worship and dedication of stones and the vanishing of arrows, these are Satan's handiwork. Abstain from it that you may prosper. Alcohol is a Satan's handiwork. Abstain from it. I only prohibit alcohol, not all veg food. And smoking. Second greatest cause of death in the world. Veg or non-veg? Veg. Can you prevent the alcoholic disease? Only way you can prevent is de-fermented. It ceases to be alcohol. Can you prevent smoking disease? Don't have tobacco. Only option is prohibition. If there is no prevention, then comes the question of prohibition. So alcohol is prohibited. There are more than 400 fatwas by Islamic scholars. Smoking is prohibited because there is no prevention. You know Kesari Dal? Kesari Dal? Indian government has banned it. It causes spastic paraplegia. Staple food of Northwest Indians. Banned. Why? It causes death also. Spastic paraplegia. Alcohol. Many countries have banned, including Saudi Arabia, including states in India have banned it. Smoking in Singapore is banned in public places, in government places, in public transport. Kesari Dal banned by India. If there's no prevention, then you can ban it. I do not know of a single government that has banned all non-veg food in general. Not a single. Yes, few non-veg food, like pork, Saudi Arabia has banned. There's no prevention, ban it. If there's no prevention, then you prohibit it. And the debate was not which is better, which is healthier, veg or non-veg. The debate was, is non-veg food permitted or prohibited? I gave a list of more than 20 points. So I can very well say that Mr. Rashmi Bhai Zaveri conveniently stopped his talk 5 minutes before, not to answer these things. If you give me 1 hour more, I will continue speaking. Wild berries, they are poisonous. Strychnine, vegetable food, they are poisonous. Datura, poisonous. What is the solution? Don't have it. You know, water. Water has so many diseases transmitted. Cholera, paratyphoid, typhoid. It causes amoebiasis, giardiasis, roundworm, pinworm, vile hepatitis. I can go on talking. Only by water. What do you do? Do you ban water? You prevent it. You purify the water. The disease will be prevented. You know milk. Milk has so many diseases. Shigella, cholera, paratyphoid, typhoid, tuberculosis, salmonellosis, brucellosis. I can go on listing. What do you do? Do you ban milk? What do? You pasteurize it. You don't ban it. You don't prohibit it. It's unmedical. Whether milk is non-veg or veg is a debatable topic. I won't argue on that. So if you cannot prevent the disease, then do you prohibit it? I have given various reasons, which Mr. Rashmi Devi hasn't replied. There's not a single government who has banned non-veg food in general. There's not a single major religion which has banned non-veg food in general. Therefore, I say that non-veg food is permitted, not prohibited. If I've heard the feelings of any vegetarians while giving the replies to the speaker, I sincerely apologize from the bottom of my heart. I would like to end the talk by giving the quotation of the glorious Quran from Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 81, which says, وَقُلْ جَعَ الْحَقُّ وَزَاكَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَهُكَ. When truth is hurled against falsehood, falsehood perishes. For falsehood is by its nature bound to perish. وَآخْرُ دَعْوَانَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.
Now we begin the open question and answer session. To extract maximum benefit in the limited time that we have available in the question and answer session, we expect the following rules to be observed. Your question should be on the topic only, that is non-vegetarian food permitted or prohibited for a human being? Questions out of the topic will not be permitted. Kindly state your question briefly and to the point. This is not a lecture time, neither a cross question time for the questioners. I repeat, kindly state your question briefly and to the point. This is not a lecture time, neither a counter question time for the questioners. Mr. Zaveri and Dr. Zakir should answer comprehensively, and each answer should not exceed 5 minutes. 4 mics have been provided in the auditorium, 2 next to the stage for the gents, and 2 in the rear central aisle for the ladies. If you wish to put a question to Mr. Zaveri, kindly queue up behind the mic with the name clip, question for Mr. Zaveri, similarly so in the ladies. And if you wish to put a question to Dr. Zakir, kindly queue up behind the mic with the name clip, question for Dr. Zakir. Only one question at a time may be asked. For your second question, you would have to go right at the back of the queue again and await your second chance. Written questions on slip papers, which are available from the volunteers in the aisles, would be given secondary preference if time permits. On your slip where you are putting a question, kindly tick or write to whom your question is addressed, Mr. Zaveri or Dr. Zakir, or it might be put aside. Kindly state your name and profession before putting forward your question so that the speakers would be in a better position to answer you. We would allow one question on each of the mics in a clockwise rotation, alternately addressed to each speaker. May we have the first question from the mic on my left? So we have first gents, ladies two, then gents again. Yes, brother, we can have the first question from you. That's for Mr. Zaveri.
Yeah.
Yes.
Respected chief guest and Mr. Zaveri, my question is, you have spoken non-vegetarian is prohibited from various angles, and you have spoken about your Lord Mahavir. Mahavir advised that killing animals and living happy at the expenses of others is prohibited. Now please explain to me, did Mahavir say that can you eat vegetarian in the sense, I mean, Mahavir never go and cut trees and have vegetable foods. He was always sitting under the tree, and the food which he has eaten is mostly fruits which has fallen from the tree. He was not plucking up the fruits and ate. So please explain to me, because you have spoken on the subject of this vegetarian, non-vegetarian is prohibited for the thing. And please explain to me what is the Jain view, because your idea is the what Mahavir said.
I understood your question.
Yeah,
I will reply. See, what Lord Mahavir stated, that even plant has got life. And he says that even eating vegetable food is, as per the Jain scriptures, is prohibited for Jain Muni. But because of constraint, everybody cannot become a Jain Muni. That is why he said that at least the unnecessary killing of animals should be avoided. He never said that eating of plant food is allowed even for Jain Munis.
Yes, sister. Question for Dr. Zakir.
Assalamu alaikum, brother Zakir. I'm Humaima here. I have a question. There are various pamphlets distributed by a vegetarian society quoting the Quran from Surah Hajj that it is not the meat nor the blood that reaches Allah, but your piety that reaches Him, thus proving that Islam prohibits killing of animals for fowl. There are many quotations from Quran and Hadith showing concern for animals.
I would like to thank the sister. She has asked a very fundamental question, that there are certain pamphlets distributed by organizations proving from the Quran and Hadith that non-veg food a Muslim should not have, it is prohibited. And this was the initiation of this debate. I didn't touch on it because, you know, they told me to keep out of religion. But since it's a question I'm compelled to answer, this was a pamphlet that the president of Krishna Foundation, Mr. Dhandak Salesha, he gave, and how this debate was initiated. He gave this pamphlet quoting from the Quran. I'll just give us the reference. The reference is a bit wrong out there, but I don't catch on to the reference. He's quoting a verse from Surah Hajj, chapter 22, verse number 37, which says that it is not their meat nor their blood which reaches Allah, which reaches God, but it is your piety that reaches Him. And I agree with that totally. It's indicating that Islam is not like certain other religions which believe that Almighty God requires blood and meat to survive. It's saying that when you sacrifice, blood doesn't reach God, meat doesn't reach God. It is your intention, it is the righteousness, it is the piety with which you sacrifice. Allah considers that piety. That is the reason when we sacrifice in Eid al-Zuha, minimum one third portion of that animal has to be given compulsory to the poor people. One third can be given to friends and relatives, and maximum one third you can keep for personal use. There is no part kept for Almighty God. Because Quran says in Surah An'am chapter 6 verse 14 that He feedeth everyone but does not require to be fed. Allah Almighty God feeds everyone, He doesn't require to be fed. This verse is clear that when you sacrifice, Allah sees your intention, He doesn't require blood and meat of the animal. There's one more quotation. There are various, it will take me 1 hour to reply to all. I'll just pick up the second quotation of Quran, the two Quranic quotation. It says in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse number 205 that when they turn away, they create mischief through the land by destroying crops and cattle. Allah loves not those who make mischief. After giving this quotation, below it's mentioned that therefore you should not have non-veg. The interpretation. The Arabic word used is nasal, which some have translated as cattle. It actually means progeny. But irrespective whether nasal you translate as cattle or progeny, if you read the context, those people who create mischief throughout the world by destroying crops and cattle or progeny, not slaughtering for food, destroying for creating mischief. Allah does not like those who make mischief. So if you kill any animal, even the plant if you kill, for making mischief, Allah doesn't like. If you say this verse refers to not having for food, that means you should not even have the crops. If I agree with you, this verse refers not to have cattle, even crops is there. It is a very wrong way of argument. They don't do self-analysis. Crop is also mentioned there. If they say by this verse, non-veg is prohibited, even veg is prohibited. It is not. Neither non-veg is prohibited, neither veg is prohibited. Certain foods which Allah has prohibited is mentioned in the Quran. The others Allah says in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse 168, eat of the good food we provide for you. Regarding animal concern. Yes, there are various hadith. If you read Sahih Bukhari volume number 3, hadith number 551, and Sahih Bukhari volume number 8, hadith number 38, it speaks about a man who gave water to a thirsty dog, and Prophet said he'll be rewarded. So people ask, do you even have reward for giving water to a thirsty dog? The Prophet said yes, for every kind act you do to the animal you will be rewarded. Imagine in the days of ignorance, Yawmul Jahiliyah, 1400 years ago, where human beings were treated like animals, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke about animal rights. Prophet said, don't overload the animals. You know, today in India, two bullocks are supposed to carry by law not more than 500 kgs. They carry more than a ton. Prophet said, don't overload them. Don't ill-treat them. Don't tie them and shoot them. Mentioned Sahih Muslim. Volume number 3. Hadith number 4812. It's also mentioned in Sahih Bukhari. Don't tie the animal and shoot them. It's mentioned in Sahih Muslim. Volume number 3. Hadith number 4810. That when you slaughter the animal, see to it that the knife is sharp so that the animal doesn't feel pain. Don't slaughter one animal in front of the other. Don't kill the animal twice. He said that, you know, adrenaline is released. It is released in the blood goes out of the body. Prophet spoke about animal concern, we should protect the rights, but for food, if it's lawful animal, you can have it. Hope that answers the question.
Yes, sister.
It's mentioned in the book 100 Facts About Egg. On page number 8 and 9, fact number 13. Ethiopians are of the view if a pregnant woman eats eggs, her child would be born bald-headed and would be deficient in reproduction. It's also mentioned in fact number 18. Some African countries believe that if a child is given to eat egg before teething, he may become mentally retarded. Are these scientific facts or are these superstitions? If you say these are scientific facts, then could you please prove it authentically? And if you say it's superstition, then why are you promoting falsehood by such books? That's 100 facts about egg. Thank you.
Thank you, sister. One thing, I have not written that book. Second thing, I have not given that book to you, and I have not referred to anything from that book. So it is not necessary to answer particularly for that book, but I can definitely say, which I have already touched upon in my subject, that because egg contains excessive protein and cholesterol and saturated fat, that is why it is not healthy for any human being, and particularly for pregnant women and children.
Yes, the next question from the mic on the right.
I am Fazal Sarang. By profession, I am an architect. My question is to Dr. Zakir Naik. Is the non-vegetarian food is the only reason for the heart disease?
That was asked a very good question. That is non-veg the only reason for the heart disease? And this was spoken by Mr. Zaveri, that flesh, animal flesh, chicken, mutton, beef causes heart disease. It can cause, he's right. And he further said, there is not a single vegetable source which contains cholesterol. If you tell that to any doctor, not the ideological vegetarian, they'll agree. Heart disease is caused when the diet contains more fat and more cholesterol, irrespective whether it's veg or non-veg. Irrespective. Non-veg. Foods do contain high cholesterol. But even vegetable foods, groundnut oil, cashew nut, coconut, ghee, butter, all this, even a common housewife knows. You know why? There are ads in the media. Half safola oil will not cause heart disease. Indicating the other oils cause heart disease. Simple. You don't have to be a doctor. It's a blatant 100% falsehood. I, being a medical doctor, I challenge Mr. Rashmi Vaidavi to answer, does butter contain fat or not? And the doctors do tell the people suffering from heart disease, don't have fat, don't have butter, don't have groundnut oil, don't have cashew nut oil. So where did you get this idea from? From these books. This book he gave to me. Correct? This book you gave to my brother. Who gave? Mr. Salesha. Mr. Salesha gave this book. In this book also it is mentioned the same thing, that there is no cholesterol in vegetables. I'm sorry if I thought, because the first time I'm meeting Mr. Zaveri here, if he didn't give these books, I apologize. But one thing, that all these books are published by Jain organizations, you know, and distributed in Bombay, cheap, cheap. Yes, I'm not
please,
blaming.
Please,
I don't want to hurt
let
anyone's
Let us not
feeling.
Have a dialogue across the this thing.
I'm not going to hurt anyone's feeling. I'm sorry, I didn't want to say that, but I was compelled. I don't want, if it's not, you said not written by Jain, it's not written.
No, you said, Dr. Zakir, that I should reply.
You will have a chance in a question answer time. Sir?
I'll let you allow you time, you know, in your time you can respond back. No, I'll allow you to respond back, anything you want in your time.
And I'll request the chairman to give me half minute more, I will disturb. Half minute more.
No, he's too smart, we'll not give him half minute more.
See, because so many allegations, egg, he told egg is the cause. Egg does contain cholesterol. It's rich in cholesterol. But it's not the major cause. Today's research and medical books also say that. That the cholesterol in the egg is not the major villain, it is the saturated fat in which you fry the egg, butter, ghee, lard, pork, which is the main villain. If you don't have this frying in ghee, butter, the less chances of having ischemic heart disease by egg. And today, amongst the population, 2/3 of the population are non-responders to cholesterol. The moment there's high intake of cholesterol, like taking egg, the liver immediately cuts its own production. And the level that reaches the blood is the same.
There are one third people who are responders to cholesterol. They have a problem. They should abstain from yolk of the egg. Otherwise, even if you have one or two egg a day, you will not have heart diseases. And if you have it with bacon, with pork, then the problem. If you fry in ghee, you'll have a problem. If you fry in groundnut oil, you'll have a problem. Causing baldness. I don't want to give examples. Even if you check here, there are many people who are bald. There are great philosophers who are bald. I don't want to take their names. I don't want to hurt your feelings. So this thing is just a research which is based on illogical assumption. A research should be practical. And the associate factor for heart disease is also alcohol as well as smoking. These two are also one of the associate causes for heart diseases. Yes, in America, heart diseases are more non-veg because they are fats. Quran says don't have an excess, this problem will be solved. Secondly, the vegetarians of America, they are affluent. It's a woke to be a vegetarian because, you know, to buy veg food is expensive. If you drive a Mercedes car, you have status. If you have veg food, it is status there. About 3 to 7% are vegetarian in America. Less than 1% are pure vegetarian. Less than 1%. Because they are affluent and they are rich, they take more care of hygiene. And many vegetarian ideologically, also, like even Mr. Rashmi Azhaveri may agree, that alcohol is prohibited, smoking is prohibited. Because of associated factors, the case of heart disease in vegetarian is less. But anyone who has food which is rich in cholesterol or fat, irrespective whether it is veg or non-veg, he will have heart disease. To prevent it, follow the guidance in the Quran, in Surah Taha, chapter number 20, verse number 81, that do not commit excesses. That reminds me of a story. In school we had learned that there was a religious priest who ate excessive food, and he had 64 laddus, and when he came back, his wife said, then why don't you have furan chutki, some digestive? So he says, Are baoli akal nahi banke che bachcho ki mata, agar churan chutki ke liye jagah hoti, to main do laddu aur na bhok leta.
Brother, the question is directed to Mr. Rashmi Zaveri. This is a book I've come across, which is named Meat Eating 100 Facts. Please, sir, this is not concerning to you.
You may put your question. Saying one book writes like that rather than saying this person's book or that. You say this book states so and so, that would be acceptable.
Okay, here is a book from Jain publication. You being a Jain, I'm asking you a question. Which is, the name is Meat Eating 100 Facts, written by Dr. Nemi Chand. And it gives a cartoonic representation of meat eating people, which I feel it's very insulting and, it's degrading, defaming. So I just want to ask you, in this Jains being tolerant, is it fair enough for Jains to publish such books which can hurt people's feeling? It's mockery. Please answer.
Yes, the speaker would not like to answer to that. I give him the full right not to answer to the question which a speaker feels is
but
not
I'm
suitable.
Just asking about
we will allow the second question. Will. That's where I speak.
The question of
okay,
being
the
tolerant.
Next question, please, for the... He passes that answer. He would not like to respond. See, the speakers have a right. I would request the questioners not to get worried or agitated in any sort. The speakers have a full right not to respond, or if you feel your question is not right or not suitable for them, they have a right not to respond back. Kindly note. So put your question and frame it in such a way that it is not vulgar, neither derogatory, and yes, so it should not be derogatory to the speaker or to a particular faith. Put it in a factual manner. This is what stated. What is your opinion? Don't give your comment in a derogatory manner. Ask, what do you say about this? Yes, don't give your opinion. Let the speaker give their opinion on the subject. Yes, sister. The next question for Dr. Zakir.
Assalamu alaikum, brother. My name is Azra. I would like to ask, in a book promoting vegetarianism by Gopinath Agarwal, on page 15th and 16th, he says that the milk a cow gives in its lifetime can satisfy 90,000 persons at one time. But the same cow is killed for flesh can satisfy 1,000 persons at one time. The same applies for goat also. He says, killing the goose that lays a golden egg daily is never a wise proposition. Do you agree with him?
Sister asked a question again from the same book. And I would like to make a clarification. Mr. Salechari, he gave these books and said you can have more books, the letter is there if you want. And these books are available in various marketplaces. People are bound to buy, etc. That's why, therefore I'm telling, I'm requesting the people. That's why. That's right. The brothers asked, why am I repeating? Because all the arguments are mentioned here. These arguments, if it's not mentioned here, I wouldn't have repeated it.
I'll be able to. Please, I think your tempers must be calm. What Mr. Jhaveri said very correctly, book is written by somebody else. It is he who should try to defend the book. Mr. Jhaveri doesn't want to defend the book. So let us forget the book and ask all questions which are pertaining to the talk.
Correct. And I agree with it. Mr. Jhaveri read from books. He didn't do a research. He read books with speaking against non-vegetarian. He read books and he presented the fact. Either I accept it or I say the fact is wrong. I can't say because I didn't write the book, no one can ask me questions. That's illogical. If you ask me any questions pertaining to non-veg food, I either say the book is false, or I say that it's illogical or it's logical. Why do you have to get irritated? It's a book promoting vegetarianism. If someone gets me a book against Islam, I will say that book is false.
Excuse me, I don't allow a debate between the audience and the speaker. The audience just put the question, the speaker can only answer the question. Don't get involved. I will not allow Dr. Zakir, neither Mr. Jhaveri to get involved in any debate with the audience. This is not a debate time for the audience. Kindly note. You can continue with the answer.
I'm going to start with the answer. You can start the timing also. If I'm going to be interrupted every time, I want to give a complete answer. I would request the chairperson not to be biased towards one person only. If they're interrupting my answer, I have to be given time. And sister raised an argument, which is there not only in this book, even other books on internet. You go to the internet, the same argument is given. First thing is milk veg or non-veg is a big question. There are vegetarians who say that milk is non-veg. This book. I'm not blaming the speaker. This book, again, says milk is non-veg. If you have milk, so many diseases. Other vegetarian foundations say no, we are lacto-vegetarian, we have milk. Whether milk is non-veg or veg, my simple question is, if you don't want to hurt the animals, when you milk the animal, it causes severe pain. You know, artificial milking of animal causes pain. You ask a breastfeeding woman, certain times she has problems and she has to extract milk artificially, it is so painful. So when you extract milk from the animal, it's painful. When you don't agree that animals are meant for food, how can you milk the animals, the cattle and the cow? It is so painful. It is nothing but robbing the animal. If you say the animal is not meant for food, and if you have the milk of that animal, you're robbing the milk which is meant for the offsprings, for the calves. And the example that was given, that a cow, on average, in a day gives 10 kgs of milk. Again, this book. If it's wrong, no problem. It's on the internet also. 10 kgs of milk in a day. In a month, 300 kgs. In a year, about 3000 kg. Do you calculate milk in kgs? In liters. Why in kgs? I don't know. Ask the author. And then further it says that 3000 kgs of milk, it will feed 6000 people.